The following sermon was recorded at Tri-State Worship Center at The Point. Tri-State Worship Center is a church of God founded in Southern Ohio where we encourage the saints, help the hurting, and embrace all people. Watch, listen, and allow Pastor Terry Wagner to help you find your path to enlightenment.
Wow. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time. Wow. I believe that what we just experienced is just a precursor of not just what's to come in heaven, but what's to come right here at Tri-State Worship Center. This miraculous, wonderful atmosphere of praise and miracles. I've seen two miracles this morning already. Two miracles. I'm going to tell you what they are. You just have to believe.
Yes.
Do you believe?
Amen.
I heard of a third miracle. I'm not going to tell you the whole story because I don't know the whole story, but Kale has a son who has a friend who OD'd a couple months ago now. He shared that in our men's meeting a couple weeks ago. They basically put him on a vent. He was in ICU for 9 days. They said he would never come out of there. And just to make I'm not like some of you who make a long story longer. I'm really going to make a long story short. He's not only out of ICU, he's out of the hospital.
Amen.
So you got to believe it. Somebody say, well, I believe it when I see it. Sometimes you got to believe it to see it.
That's right. Yes.
Hello?
Amen.
Amen. We're going to jump back into our series on the Ten Commandments. I saw a cartoon. It was a Frank and Ernest cartoon. One of them's coming down the mountainside with the Ten Commandments, and the crowd is yelling out, "Hey, give us a copy. We'd like to begin to look for some loopholes." That's what we do, isn't it? That's what we do. Matter of fact, I heard a story about a Jewish guy who went to a Christian man, and he confronted the Christian man. He says, "Hey, I hope you know that you guys borrowed the Ten Commandments from us." The Christian looked back at him and responded and said, "Hey, we may have borrowed them, but we ain't keeping them." Been slow this week, hasn't it? You all right? Elbow your neighbor real quick. Just make sure they're still with us. So I want to continue a series of sermons entitled The Ten Commandments, Living a Relevant Life. Living a Relevant Life. And what I mean by that is I think that too often, too many believers go through life and you just exist. You're not really overcoming. You're not having that abundant joy. As a matter of fact, if you were here last week, that research from the relevant study that was done said that of the thousands of churches that they surveyed and the thousands upon thousands of believers, they were looking for the believers who say they were living that abundant life. They want to know who is it that's living that overcoming life. And of all the thousands of people they surveyed, 11% of Christians said they were living that kind of life. I think if we're going to live that kind of life, it's going to make an impact in this world. If we're going to live the kind of life that's going to be a relevant life, it's going to be as we understand and follow the Ten Commandments. As a matter of fact, we've been using as our foundational scripture, 1 John chapter 5, verse 3, and we're going to read it out of the Message. And again, I realize that's a paraphrase of the Bible, but I just think the way it says it helps us to understand it. It simply says this: do we love God? That's a question mark. Do we love God? Do we keep His commands? Well, if we love God, listen, the proof that we love Him is that we keep His commandments. And that if we keep His commandments, they are not burdensome. Here's what He's saying. If you and I love God, we're going to keep His commandments. And if we keep His commandments, it's not really that hard to do. What I've discovered in my own life is the hardest thing between me not keeping a commandment and keeping a commandment is me. If I could ever just get myself out of the way, keeping the commandments of God are not burdensome. It's not troublesome. It's not heavy. It's not hard. But if I want to prove to God that I love Him, I'm going to prove that I love Him by keeping His commandments. And so we've gone through five of them so far. The first one was that you shall have no other gods before me, Exodus chapter 20, verse 3. And here's the question that we struggled with. Do I embrace God unconditionally? I don't want to re-preach that sermon, but what you need to understand is He's going to be first place in your life or He's going to be no place in your life. There is no such thing as a second place for God. He is God of all or not at all. And that's what this first commandment says. Do we accept him unconditionally over our family, over our church, over our job, over our money, over our house, over our recreation? Do we accept him unconditionally as the only God that there is? The second command that we found was in verse 4, you shall not make for yourselves a carved image. And here's the question that we struggled with. Am I worshiping God as he is? Am I worshiping God as he is, or am I worshiping God as the reduced image that everybody else has made him into? Again, I know I've said it already, but somebody said, hey, how come we don't have any pictures of Jesus in the church? Well, we don't have a picture of Jesus in the church because we don't know what Jesus looked like. I mean, we have some pictures of what people think he might look like, which most of them are wrong. You know, the senior picture? Caucasian, long brown hair? Probably not. Middle Eastern descent, probably dark complected, probably darker, curlier hair. But when we do that, what happens is we begin to reduce the image of who he is because we say, well, that must be what he looked like. And so he says, don't do that. Just accept me for who I am. God is a person to be loved and worshipped, not a resource to be used. And our problem is that once we allow those other images to reduce in us who he is, then what we find ourselves doing is worshiping what is to be used and using what is to be worshiped. And he says, don't do that. Week 3, we talked about the third commandment found in verse 7. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. And we ask this question. Are we trying to manipulate God? There's basically two ways that we misuse the name of the Lord. And it's not just cursing. The first way that we misuse the name of the Lord is when we use it as an expression rather than in reverence. Remember the Oxford Dictionary, the first definition of the name Jesus was a vulgarity. The second definition is he was the founder of the Christian religion. The first definition is it was used as a vulgarity. So that's one way we misuse the name. The second way we misuse the name is when we attach that name to our purpose or to our cause. In other words, if you'll just give me $39.95, I will give you a handkerchief with my handprint on it and a vial of holy water. Because the Lord said, and all of a sudden I've attached his name to my purpose. If you'll just plant a $1,000 seed in my ministry, all of your family will be saved. You're going to plant it today? You're working on it. That's attaching God's name to my cause, and that's misusing the name of the Lord, and we should not do that. Then we looked at the fourth commandment, found in verses 8 through 10. Remember the Sabbath day, keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord, and you shall not do work. And here's the question we ask. Am I living a balanced life? These are struggles that we have to have a relevant life. Am I living a balanced life? Listen to me. I don't care what's going on in your work situation. I don't care what's going on in your work situation. Work is a gift from God.
Amen.
We dignify the work when we do the work as unto the Lord. I don't care what it is. I don't care if you're clipping dogs or if you're saving people by being a brain surgeon. It doesn't matter. Whatever it is that you do, you should do it as unto the Lord, because work is a gift from the Lord, and we dignify the work by doing it as unto the Lord. And when we complete our work, that's when we get to rest. That's when we get to rest, because your work is an expression of God in you. Your work is an expression of God in you, and your work reflects His character in you. People should be able to look at how you work and say, that person must be a Christian. See, it got real quiet then. They said, no, that's not what they... Yes. They should be able to tell a difference. They should be able to see that you're doing all that you do is unto the Lord. Then the last commandment that we looked at was the fifth commandment. That was a couple weeks ago. And you find it in chapter 20, verse 12. Honor your father and mother, that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord your God is giving you. And here's the question that we ask. Do I love the people that God has placed around me? Do I love the people that God has placed around me? And frankly, I got to be honest with you. When I was a little guy, I had my own ideas about that particular commandment. I thought that honoring my parents so that my days upon the earth would be long really meant that if I didn't honor them, my dad would kill me. I believe that. And if you grew up in my house, you'd have believed it too. And in that commandment, there's not really a formula for this. But the principle is clear, and here it is. The principle is those who follow Christ are to give weight to the needs and the interests of other people, especially their parents. You give weight to the needs and to the interests of your parents. Now, if you're a parent this morning, let me say this very distinctly to you before we get to the sixth commandment. It should be your goal to create an environment and an atmosphere for your child to be able to accomplish the will of God. If the will of God is for them to honor you, you should create an atmosphere and an environment where they can honor you. See, the problem in our world today is that some parents don't feel an obligation to do that. And the Bible is really plain and commands us and speaks to us directly as parents, whether you're old or young, doesn't matter, that we should create that environment and that atmosphere where our children can fulfill the will of God. I can tell you this, that there's probably not a more fulfilling thing in life than to know that you are helping your children fulfill the will of God. So not only do children have an obligation in that commandment, parents have an obligation in that commandment as well. There was a Sunday school teacher that was teaching and discussing about the Ten Commandments and with her 5 and 6 year old class. And after explaining this particular commandment, you should honor your father and your mother, here's the question that she asked. Is there a commandment that teaches us how to treat our brothers and sisters? And without missing a beat, one of the kids said, "Thou shalt not kill," which is the one we're going to talk about next. It's found in verse 13, Exodus chapter 20. And I'm reading out of the New King James Version that says, "You shall not murder." You shall not murder. And here's the question we're going to struggle with for a few minutes this morning. Am I harboring anger, hatred, or bitterness in my heart? Listen to me very carefully. Some of us will sit here this morning and say, "Number 6, I got that. I ain't never killed nobody." And we're going to miss it if we're not careful. Because there's a whole lot more involved this morning than just killing people with a physical act of violence. And so let's just ask the Lord to help us this morning to hear from Him. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank You again for Your awesomeness. I thank You that You are such a great God. I thank You that You're a God in heaven that loves Your people. And not only the people that have committed to You, but those people that are still yet to commit to You. I'm thankful that You are a loving, graceful God. And this morning, as we continue to look at the Ten Commandments, help us to understand that if we love You, we will keep Your commandments. And if we keep Your commandments, it will not be burdensome. It won't be hard. So Lord, just let that resonate in us. Let our lives be changed so that we can live a relevant, impactful life for the kingdom of heaven as we follow Your Ten Commandments. Help us this morning. I pray that in Christ's name. Someone say amen.
Amen.
If you were to look at my cell phone, you would find thousands of pictures. Thousands. Matter of fact, I think the last time I checked, there was about 3,700 pictures on my cell phone. Most of those pictures are of my family. Somehow, some way, people in my family. And a lot of those pictures have pictures of my wife on them. And I'm just going to confess to you right up front, I married way above my pay grade. She is... She is a beautiful woman. Her mother was a beautiful woman. You know, I always say, if you want to know what your wife's going to look like when she gets older, just look at her mom. I'd say that in the first service, and there were a couple guys that went... Vicky's mom was a beautiful, beautiful woman, and Vicky's a beautiful woman. And the reason that I bring that up to you is that if someone saw a picture of her 100 years from now, say they bought our house 100 years from now, and they go through there and they find a picture of her, and they wipe the dust off, and they say, "Wow, she's pretty. I wonder who she was," and they just kind of tossed it aside. Now, I would never do that. I would never toss a picture of my wife aside, and the reason is because that picture bears an image of somebody I love. The image is somebody that I love. I would never do that. And the reason that human life is so valuable is because we bear the image of somebody who loves us.
Amen.
We bear the image of God. In the beginning, He made us. He said, "I'm going to make you in my image and after my likeness." And the reason that human life is so valuable is because we reflect the image of God. Now, you can go to some laboratories and different doctors and chemists, and they're going to tell you that we're made mostly of water and a few chemicals, and that the human body is really not worth that much. But the Bible tells me in Genesis chapter 1 that men and women are made in the likeness and after the image of God. I get my value not from what somebody else thinks of me, but I get my value when I reflect the image of who God is. That's what makes me who I am. And the offense, the problem, if you can say it that way, in destroying human life is it's destroying the image of God. Listen carefully. When we offend the sixth commandment, however we do it, the offense there is that we somehow are destroying the image of God. And we need to keep that in mind. There's many ways of destroying another person's life besides homicide. Listen, there are ways of destroying the image of God, somebody's life, other than just homicide. And so I think we need to listen because the sixth commandment is going to come a lot closer to home than a lot of us might think. So I want you to be patient with me as we go through some of these different looks at the sixth commandment. This is not the kind of sermon necessarily that's going to give you a chill bump. This is not the kind of sermon necessarily going to make you feel good. I actually have prayed, Lord, convict us all. Lord, let your convicting power arrest all of us, because I'm just going to make this statement. I didn't make this statement in the first service. I'm going to make it now. I guarantee you that everybody in this place this morning, including me, have offended the sixth commandment. I guarantee it. And by the time we're done, I think you'll see what I'm talking about. In Genesis chapter 9, verse 3, God tells Moses, he said, every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. I have given you all these things, even the green herbs. Now look at me. I want you to know right up front, I'm not an animal hater. Okay? I know you've heard that I am. But I'm not. I know. I'm not a hater, not necessarily a fan, but I'm not a hater. But God says that you and I can fish the seas and we can harvest the animals. He made a chasm. He made a distinction there. As a matter of fact, a few verses later in verse 6 of Genesis chapter 9, he said, whoever sheds man's blood, by man his blood shall be shed. For in the image of God, he made him. So God makes this a very clear distinction. Look at this. There's a vast chasm between fish and animals and plants and human beings. There's a difference between us. Now listen carefully. I'm not a hater. As a matter of fact, most of you know by now that Vicky has a cat. I don't have a cat. Vicky has a cat. The cat's name is Walt, which is short for Walt Disney. Okay? Holly named the cat, obviously. And they tell me that cats are smart. That's what I hear. But I'm not convinced. Because that cat tries every day for me to pet it. Every day. That cat will do something to try to get me. I'm not going to pet that cat. I don't want that cat to think that he and I are friends. Because we're not. Every morning when I get ready to walk out of the bedroom, on my cell phone, I disarm our home alarm system. Which I want everyone in this place to know we have one. And it's like Pavlov's dog. You know, when the bell would ring, he would salivate because he knew food was coming. Every time the alarm thing says, disarmed, that cat makes a beeline for the bedroom door. He knows I'm getting ready to walk out that door. And I walk out the door, I got to kind of put my foot out there to keep him from coming in because Vicky's still asleep. And when I shut the door, first thing he does, he rolls over on his back like this. And I walk by him. Stupid cat. I go sit down in the living room and I put my shoes on. The cat follows me in the living room. You know what he does? I look at him and sometimes I do talk to him. I just don't like it when people talk to animals because I really don't think they understand. You know, you can look at a dog and say, oh, come here, boy, and he'll jump on you, right? But you can look at him and go, oh, come here, boy, and he'll take off running. He don't know what you're saying. He's just listening to your voice. So that I look at the cat and say, if you think I'm petting you, you're crazy. And I walk on out. So I listen, the cat lives in my house. We take good care, or Vicky takes good care of him. I don't take care of him. And so don't think this morning when I say this that I'm some kind of an animal hater. But the simple fact is there is a chasm, there is a division, there is a separation between human beings and animals. Now here's why I say that. Here's the problem. Unfortunately, there are some people who think that human beings are nothing more than advanced animals. And when we begin to think that, then we begin to damage the image of God. We begin to lessen the image of God when we try to put that on the same plane. Now listen, I know there are people who love their animals. My daughter has 3 dogs. And when she sent me a video yesterday, a video of her laying with one of her dogs. And she goes, show this to Jonas and Keegan. And of course, Jonas and Keegan loved it. They were like, Winston! And I was like, why are you wasting memory on my phone for? But I know some of you love your animals. We had a lady who used to attend here. And she was a senior citizen. And really, the only other being in her house was her little dog. She loved that dog. And one particular season, the dog got sick. She took the dog to Columbus and had surgery that cost $8,000. Surgery on the dog. I won't say what I'm thinking, but I'm not sure that was a wise steward of God's money. But she had it and she could use it. And so here's what happens when we began to blur the lines between animals and humans. We began to lessen the image of God in humanity, and when we do that, we are murdering. We're murdering. I'm going to show you how I get to that in just a moment, because Jesus told us that. When society can't tell the difference between a dog and grandma, it's a problem. Here's what I mean by that. 6 states in the United States of America, 6 states have laws on their books that euthanasia is okay. Euthanasia is assisted dying. Okay, and here's how they got there. Here's the logic. The logic goes like this. I love my dog. I don't want my dog to suffer. When my dog gets to a point that he can't enjoy life anymore, I'm going to take him to the vet. I'm going to have him put down. If I can do this for my dog, why can't I do this for my grandma? 6 states have bought into that logic and say, yeah, when you get to a point where you think life is just not worth it anymore, it's okay to assist someone in dying. Now, let me just say this right up front. God is the giver of life, and He's the one that decides when life is over. You and I don't decide that. That's not our job. That's what Adam and Eve thought was going to be their job when the serpent said, you're not really going to die. You're just going to become like God. You're going to know everything. And they thought, yeah, that's a good deal. Let's do it. And suddenly they thought they were going to know everything, and they really didn't. And the simple fact is that when life comes, it comes because God says life. And when life is over, it's because God says life is over. You and I are not to decide that. And the problem is when society gets to a point where they can't tell the difference between a dog and grandma, we lose the biblical teachings of what we are and who we are and the image of God that we have and this humanity that we are, the uniqueness, if you will, of human life. Look at your neighbor and say, you're different. somebody said, finally. It's not about what you think. It's not about what I think. It's about what God has to say. And what God has said is this. What God has separated, let no man join together. Right? Plant life, animal life, human beings. I hope that you can get that into your mind, because it's going to be important as we go through this for you to understand where I'm coming from and what I think the Bible says. We've all held differing views on this 6th commandment. Christianity holds differing views on thou shalt not kill. And the 2 things that seem to come up the most that we're really not even going to talk about this morning, when you begin to talk about the 6th commandment, is war and capital punishment. Well, how can you go to war and kill people? The 6th commandment says thou shalt not kill. How can you believe in the death sentence when the Bible says you shall not kill? Now listen, the 6th commandment you cannot use to resolve that argument. Because there are other laws and commands that God gives that really have nothing to do with the 6th commandment. For instance, there are times when the death of one person saves the lives of many more. Let me give you one example. David and Goliath. God empowered and enabled David to kill Goliath, which then was going to save a lot of other people's lives for generations to come. If the Philistines would have taken over and the Hebrews would have become slaves or in bondage to the Philistines, that would have been a problem. So God allowed David to take Goliath's life. Now, I don't know where you stand on history. Maybe if you come from the revisionist side of history, you don't believe in the Holocaust. I do believe it happened. I do believe that number of people were killed. And the taking out or the end of Hitler's life saved a lot more than what was killed. They say it saved a lot of people by taking out. You would say, well, listen, are you saying it was okay to kill Hitler? Yep. I'm saying it. It was okay. Because that is not resolved in the sixth commandment. That's not what this commandment's about. And so we can debate about that. We can argue about that. But the real reality is that you cannot use it to resolve that argument. But you can resolve it. You can resolve a lot of other arguments by using the sixth commandment. And I want to talk about a few of those this morning. Number one, let's look at some subjects that this commandment does deal with. Taking of your neighbor's life. That's murder. That's one of the things that this commandment talks about. The first application of the sixth commandment is very simple. God forbids acts of murder even when you think you're justified in doing it. Now, I know what some of you are thinking right away. I just spent $100 to get my concealed weapon permit. Don't say nobody said amen right there, right? I want nobody to know I got it. I'm not talking about when you have to defend your family. I'm not talking about when you have to defend yourself. I'm talking about in those times when people murder other people. And they may feel like it's justifiable, but it's not, because God's the one who said in Romans chapter 12, verse 19, vengeance is what? Mine, saith the Lord, I will repay. So it's not our place to do that. It's not our place to act out. Think of the night before the crucifixion. Jesus is praying. His disciples are sleeping. The disciples hear the Roman soldiers coming, and suddenly there's a scene in the Garden of Gethsemane. And Jesus is there with his disciples. The soldiers come in, and what does Simon Peter do? Simon Peter draws his sword. And I don't think it was really Simon Peter's goal just to cut an ear off. I think Simon Peter's goal was to split the skull open of one of those Roman soldiers. I think that's what he just missed. But what did Jesus do? Jesus said, this is not about you, Simon Peter. They're not here to attack you. They're not here to offend you. And he picked up that ear and he put it back on the soldier's head, because that was the wrong use of force. Jesus said, this is not about you. Our problem is that when we think it's about us, all of a sudden we want to act on getting revenge. We want to act on doing what God said he'll do. He said, listen, vengeance is mine. You just stay away from it. And Jesus told him, he said, put your sword away. And he healed the guy. So the first thing that we look at when we look at the sixth commandment is that we shouldn't murder our neighbor. We should not take the life of our neighbor. But the second thing that we would look at is that we cannot take the life of our unborn neighbor. Amen. I'll just tell you right now, the Church of God, most of Christianity, stands against abortion. The reason abortion is wrong is because it's taking the life of an unborn child who is made in the image of God. That's why it's wrong. Now, let me just pause here long enough to say to some of you that may have suffered through that, it's not unforgivable. It's not unforgivable. But it is wrong. It is a sin. It is something that we go to God and ask him to forgive us, because while the child is still in the womb, still unborn, that is a neighbor who is made in the image of God. And we're told not to take that life. You see, God has an active relationship with the development of a child, even at conception. In the womb and during that gestation period. Perhaps the most beautiful expression of that is King David. He wrote in the 139th Psalm, listen to what he said. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you're there. If I make my bed in hell, you're there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, your right hand shall hold me. Look at me for a minute. David recognizes that God is with him everywhere he goes, but that he doesn't stop there. He goes on then and says, my frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed, and in your book they are all written, the days fashioned for me, when as yet there were none of them. Listen to me before we move to the next one. I'm not talking about potential life. I'm talking about a life that's full of potential. And it begins at conception when God says, let there be life. And there's life. Sometimes we don't understand it. Sometimes we were expecting it. Sometimes we weren't. But God is the giver of life. And he's the one that decides when that life is over. Now let me speak to some of you that may have suffered through the tragedy of miscarriage. That happens sometimes. But even in those times, that child is known by God. Think about that for a moment. If that does not bring you some comfort, I don't know what would. Just knowing that even though that child was not able to come from the womb, God still knew that child, and He still protects that child by holding it in His hand. What an awesome thought that is, even in those tragic times of miscarriage. So you're not to kill your neighbor. You're not to kill your unborn neighbor. What about taking the life of an elderly person or the infirmed person? We talked about that a little bit a while ago. Euthanasia. Euthanasia involves making this decision that a person's life is just no longer worth living and some action needs to be taken. And that is not our place to do that. And when I say that, I want you to hear the difference between ending life and ending treatment. Some people sitting in this sanctuary this morning, you've been confronted with family members that say, I want to sign a DNR, a do not resuscitate, or I don't want to have a feeding tube, or I don't want to be in hospice. And that's a family's request of the denial of treatment. But that's not the denial of life. That's not the ending of someone's life. I can tell you the story of my mother-in-law when she was dying with cancer. She had told Vicki and her brother that she had a DNR, that she wanted to die at home, and that she didn't want a feeding tube. And the time was coming close to her leaving this world, and I was sitting on the back porch with Vicki's brother. His name's Mark. And Mark looked at me and he said, this just ain't right. And I said, what are you talking about? He said, it's not the cancer killing her now. She's starving to death. And I said, listen, God's the one who's going to decide when she dies. I still believe God can lift her up off that bed. I still believe that God has healed you this morning as we prayed for your heart. I still believe that God's healed Christy Douglas, even though she's going to go for her third treatment this Tuesday. I still believe God has healed that. And I do know that God does that. But sometimes ultimate healing is leaving this life, going to the next. And I looked at Mark and I said, listen, God's the one who decides when life is over. You're just being a good son right now. You're doing what your mommy asked you to do. And that's being a good son, but you're not the one deciding when she's going to die. Listen, to those of you who have had to go through that difficult time of deciding whether there's going to be a DNR or whatever it might be for your particular family, that's a difficult time, but you're not deciding when someone lives or dies. Because there's a difference between ending treatment versus ending someone's life. And so it's not our place to decide when someone's life is not worth living any longer. It's not our place to decide that. That's God's place to decide that. I've walked into hospital rooms, and I'm getting ready to talk to some of you right now because you've been in those rooms when I've said this. I've walked into hospital rooms where everybody around the person has already put the person in the grave. Becky, stand up a minute. You were the person when they said, oh, what are we going to do? We don't have a plot. We don't have a casket. Okay, you can sit back down. It's enough. And you know what I did? I looked at her family and I said, how about let's not put her in the grave yet? That's not for us. And she's not and won't be. Amen. Going to get a good report from the doctor this week, as a matter of fact. I believe that. Listen to me. It's not our place to decide that. So the next time you have a family member that's suffering, maybe in the hospital, maybe even in ICU. I got a call from Shelly the other day. Mackie was in really, really bad shape. Can I tell that story? I went up to see Mackie on Monday. He's in ICU and was unresponsive. He was on a vent, had prayer with him, talked to him like he could hear me, but I don't know if he did or not. So Shelly sent me a text message. She said, I know my dad's a believer. I know he prays every day, but I just need to make sure that he's ready to go. So he couldn't communicate. All he could do was blink his eyes the next day. I went up there. And so I leaned over. I said, Mackie, you know who it is? And he blinked his eyes. I said, well, one for yes, two for no. Yeah, I blinked his eyes. I said, listen, it's a tough time, isn't it? And he got a little bit bigger about it like that. And I said, your family's worried about you. I said, there's a lot of people in this hospital worried about you. But the thing that we need to know most is that you're okay with God. So I'm going to ask you this question. I'm just going to ask you, is everything okay between you and God? If so, I want you to blink one time. This is exactly what he did. His eyes were closed when I was talking to him. He went... But you know what? He came out of ICU. I think he's out now and was coming out. Is he out yet?
He's not out yet. He's having blood pressure problems now.
But he's better than he was Monday. Listen, it's not our place to decide. You know what it's our place to do? Believe. Let's believe. I got in trouble one time for saying that when Lynn Price was going through her cancer struggle. And I said, how about let's quit talking about when Lynn passes. Let's start talking about believing for healing. And I got in trouble for saying that. because I was insensitive. No, I want to believe what the Bible says. It says that we'll live until God says we can't live no more. And when God says it's over, it's over. That's that. So let's talk about the last obvious thing before I talk about some things I think we've all done. But let's talk about what about when we get to the point where we want to take our own life. That's a very unfortunate situation. Because people do come to a place sometimes where they feel like that their life is no longer worth living. People do get to that point where they don't think the world would miss them if they weren't here. Let me say first and foremost, let me speak to that person right now, this moment. That is not true. That's not true. You are made in the image of God. And because you're made in the image of God, your life has value no matter what anybody else thinks. Because you're in the image of God, you have value because God made you and God loves you. He is the trustee and the owner of your life. I get asked this question a lot because I'm a pastor. If someone commits suicide, are they going to hell? I get asked that question. And even as I said that just now, some of you probably got a little bit more aware of this sermon this morning. You thought, I'd like to hear the answer to that. Well, can I tell you something? I don't know the answer to that. Because I'm not the judge. God's the judge. Some of you should be thankful that I'm not the judge. You should be thankful that God's the judge. But I do know this. When you listen to a voice that tells you that your life is not worth it and that your hope is gone and that the world wouldn't miss you, you're not listening to the right voice. You're listening to the voice of the enemy. The voice of the enemy wants to convince us that we can arrive at that dark place that leads some people to do some drastic things that are not what God wants them to do because God's the one who decides. But in the end, where does that person end? I don't know. I don't know where they end up. I do know this, that it's not God that wants me to take my life. It's obvious in the Sixth Commandment as well as a bunch of other scriptures throughout the Bible. It's not God who wants me to take my life. It must be the enemy that wants me to take my life. And I would hate for my last act on this earth to be something that the enemy wanted me to do. So I don't know the ultimate answer to that, but I do know this. If you're here this morning and for some reason you've listened to that wrong voice, hear the right voice this morning. Not the voice of Terry Wagner, but the voice of God when He says, I love you. My grace is sufficient. Doesn't matter what you've gone through. Where sin abounds, grace super abounds. And your life is worth something. Your life is worth something. And this world would miss a person who decided that on their own. So you need to understand that the fact that life can be painful does not diminish the importance of God. Listen to that again. Hear it again. The fact that life can be painful does not diminish who God is. This life is painful sometimes. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Finally. So hear the words of the Lord through the prophet Jeremiah in chapter 29, verse 11. If you've been in church any at all, you've heard this verse several times. God says, for I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. That's what God thinks of you, regardless of what life deals you, regardless of what other people say about you. That's how God feels about you, and that's how we should base our life. That's how we should determine our steps, is by what God thinks of us. There are so many believers that are living less than victorious lives. You're living a miserable existence. You're a believer. You're going to go to heaven, but you're really not enjoying the journey. And the reason is because we've allowed everybody else to tell us about us. We've allowed everybody else to define who we are. We've allowed everybody else to dictate the things about us that we may know already. But listen to me. Listen. We would quit spending so much time worrying about what other people think of us if we realize they rarely do. Can I say it again? We would spend less time worrying about what everybody thinks of us if we realize they rarely do. What we need to know is what God thinks about us. You know what He thinks about us? He knows the thoughts that He has towards you. They're thoughts of peace and not of evil. They're thoughts of a future and they're thoughts of hope. That's what we need to get a hold of. Amen?
Amen.
So let's go to the next level for just a minute before we pray. You may be sitting there right now and here's what you're saying. Well, I'm in good shape. I've never done any of those things. Well, I'm about to bust your bubble. I've never killed anyone. I've never had an abortion. I've never practiced euthanasia. I've never committed suicide. So that must mean that I have kept the sixth commandment to the T. No. No, it does not. As a matter of fact, Jesus made it clear that the scope of this commandment, the reach of this commandment, goes beyond acts of murder. Listen, Jesus said the scope of this commandment goes beyond the acts of murder to the thoughts of your mind and the desires of your heart. Now you should probably perk up and listen just a little bit, because I'm going to give you a couple of what those things are that cause us to break the sixth commandment. If you are a verbally abusive person, you are breaking the sixth commandment because you're destroying the life of a person that is the image of God. You say, well, I'm not sure I believe that. Well, first I say, I don't care if you believe it or not, because it's in the Bible. Jesus, who came to earth and took all of the laws and commandments that were external, and he made them internal. And here's what he said in Matthew chapter 5, verse 21. He said, you've heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you that whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whoever says to his brother, Raca, which is roughly translated, hey, you're worthless, you're useless, shall be in danger of the council, but whoever says you fool shall be in danger of hellfire. Jesus makes it so clear right here that using rude, insulting, abusive, or demeaning language is a direct violation of the sixth commandment. You don't have to amen me. It's all right. I know it's true. Let me say it again, because some of us need to hear it. You may not have killed anybody. You may not have had an abortion. You may not have been involved in a euthanasia situation. And you may not have been involved in suicide. But anybody who has rude, insulting, abusive, or demeaning language, you are in direct violation of the sixth commandment. And if you love God, you will keep his commandments. And keeping his commandments is not burdensome. You know, it's really not hard to be nice to other people. You know what keeps us from being nice to other people? Us. Well, you don't know what they did to me. Listen, when you can bring me a Bible, any translation you want, that says you are excused from the sixth commandment if someone hurt your feelings. We live in a world where everybody's feelings gets hurt. Amen. Everybody gets hurt about something anymore. You can't say Merry Christmas. That's offensive. Listen to me. If we are rude, if we are insulting, if we are abusive or demeaning in how we talk to somebody, direct violation. And you and I who do those things are in the most need of forgiveness. What about hatred? 1 John 3 and 15 says, whoever hates his brother is a murderer. Whoever hates his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. Whoever hates his brother is a murderer. You violate the sixth commandment when you have an issue of hatred with your brother or with your sister. Somebody once said that racial hatred is the leading violator of the sixth commandment. And I have a tendency to agree with that. Jesus said to love your enemies. Jesus said to do good to those who mean harm towards you. And if we have hatred, he says we're a murderer. And we will not have eternal life. I'm not saying it. It's in the Bible. Linda, if you'll come. The last one I would share with you is recklessness. This is the one that if you have sailed through everything that I've said so far and you went, I've not offended any of those, I'm good with the sixth commandment. If you've been able to do that so far, which I don't think anybody in this place has, I'm going to get you on this one. Recklessness. Listen carefully. God calls us to love our neighbor as ourselves. Guess what that means? What that means is that he wants you to take care of you. Yeah. He wants us to take care of ourselves because you and I are stewards of what God has given us. He's given us the temple of the Holy Spirit. And he says, now I want you to manage that. I want you to take care of that. And here's how we break the sixth commandment with recklessness: by neglecting a proper pattern of sleep. Oh, come on, Pastor Terry. That ain't got nothing to do with sixth commandment. Yes, it does. Because you're to be able to take care of this. It drives me crazy sometimes when I say to someone, hey, how you doing? Man, I'm tired. I'm just tired. What time did you go to bed last night? 3 a.m. Well, go to bed at 11. You won't be as tired. Somebody left the first service this morning and said, hey, I try to go to bed early, but I just can't go to sleep. How do you go to sleep? I use the old one. Don't count sheep. Talk to the shepherd. You know what? Some of y'all fall asleep while I'm preaching. I know you'll fall asleep while you're praying. So just pray. You'll be out like a light. We break the sixth commandment by being addicted to our work. We break the sixth commandment by, let me see how I can say this nicely, the improper use of food. Yeah. Overeating. You're telling me I'm breaking the sixth commandment because I eat too much? Yep. Why? This is the image of God. If I do anything that hurts the image of God, I'm breaking the sixth commandment. This is the image of God. I need to eat right. Drinking and the use of drugs. You're breaking the sixth commandment. Oh, come on, Pastor Terry. That's not true, is it? Yeah. You mean like just drinking a beer? Listen to me. I don't know if a beer will send someone to hell. Again, I'm not the judge, but I do know this. I've never seen anybody drink a beer and say, you know, this makes me feel closer to God. I've never seen that. I'm thinking we're supposed to do all that we can do to draw closer to Him, right? Hello? I've never seen that. I've never seen anybody go, praise the Lord. And listen, now, if you smoke, that's between you and God. I'm just saying, I've never seen or heard anybody say, you know what, I pounded a few brewskis and just worshiped God all night long. No, you didn't. You might have worshiped something, but it wasn't God. He gave us this temple. We're supposed to be taking care of it. Now, here's the last one on that recklessness one. We're going to pray, and somebody will be thankful that we're praying. Whew, man, I hope he quits soon. I heard an amen. Even the lack of proper exercise can be a violation of the sixth commandment. Guilty. Guilty. Gonna have a good altar call this morning. I got a treadmill in my office. I could just put the phone on mute while some of you are talking and be walking. Made that rhyme. Didn't even mean to. And I don't. You know what's on that treadmill? Some tools. Some clothes. It's right there. God said, I want you to love your neighbor as you love yourself. And if you really love yourself, you're going to take care of the body that God has given you. Some of us shorten our years on this earth because of what we do to this body. Stand with me. Listen to this statement. Listen very carefully. A community that values life, a community that values life begins with a community of people who value their own life. A community that values life begins with a community of people that value their own life. That I am made in the image of God. And if we listen to these commandments, they're like warning signs on the road. That if we will pay attention to them, we can avoid some trouble. They're also like directional signs on the road. That if we'll pay attention to them, it'll take us around to the places that we need to go, not where we don't need to be. And if you reduce this sixth commandment to two things, here's what it is. You ready? Number one, embrace life. Number two, pursue peace. If we can pursue peace with our brothers and sisters, our neighbors, if you will, we're not in violation of this sixth commandment. So we need to embrace life, pursue peace. We do those two things, we show the Lord that we love Him by keeping His commandments, and it's really not that hard to do. Embrace life, pursue peace. Well, Pastor Terry, you don't understand. I don't have to understand. I don't even have to know your story. But you need to know what the Bible says. The Bible says, embrace life, pursue peace. Amen?
Amen.
Lord, thank you this morning for your awesomeness. Thank you this morning for your word that gives us the instructions for this life before heaven. I pray, God, that somehow, some way, as we are continuing to go through these commandments, that you will help us to understand and know what they mean to us to have a relevant life, to have a life to make an impact on this earth. I pray, Lord, that as we've looked at this sixth commandment, that we wouldn't just limit our view to murder, to the taking of life, but that we would expand our view to understand that Jesus said those things that are external now are internal. And if I just think bad thoughts about somebody, if I just say something bad about somebody, I'm in direct violation of the sixth commandment. And if I love God, I keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome. So help us this morning, Lord God, to wrap our minds around that. I thank you for that. I ask it in Christ's name. Keep your heads bowed for just a moment. You may be here this morning. You may not be in a right relationship with Jesus Christ. These commandments are for you, but you'll never be able to follow them unless you have surrendered your life to him. You'll never be able to do the things that God's called you to do until you surrender to him. And he has made that so easy for us to do. He said, if I can confess with my mouth and believe in my heart that Christ is Lord, that God raised him from the dead, that I can be saved. He said that he loved us so much he sent his son to die for us, that if we would just believe on him, we wouldn't perish, but we would have everlasting life. But what you have to do right now is you've got to decide something. You have to decide, I'm good enough on my own to make it. I'm good enough on my own to make it. Or you have to decide, I know I'm not good enough on my own and I need help. And if you decide I'm not good enough on my own and I need help, what you need is Jesus. And we would love to pray with you this morning. So I'm going to ask the praise team to sing this chorus through just a couple of times. And as they sing, if you're here, you're not in a right relationship with Jesus Christ, I'd love to pray with you. It's not the prayer that saves you. It's the intent of your heart. But I would just love to pray with you. So I'm going to ask them to sing. And as they sing, just step out from where you're at and come. Let me pray with you. Would you do it right now?
We hope that you have been ministered to by today's sermon. Our prayer and hope is that you find comfort and encouragement in these words, as well as instruction and correction.